Hi, everyone. I just really have a little story to tell. Back in the 1980s, I was editor of a magazine called Television Radio Age. And I used to occasionally have lunch with a public relations executive for NBC Television by the name of Owen Kamara. And Owen would tell me that his wife, Betty, was a jazz singer. But I never really got to hear her. And so this was my opportunity. So we've been emailing back and forth. And I'm really looking forward to it. And without any further ado, I'd like to introduce Bill Crow on bass, Betty Kamara on piano.
Thank you. And that's when I lived in New Jersey, and I've been living in Florida now. I say I moved there the turn of the century, because it was 1999, and I was before the new century. And this is really exciting. I'm so happy to be here, and I see so many familiar faces, and some of them are even happy. So it's good. I'd like to start with this tune that a few of you will know, and a few of you might even know who wrote it. Very appropriate, even for an opener or a closer. It's called I Love Being Here With You. I love the East, I love the West, the North or South, I love the best. I will make over there as a guest. I love being here with you. I love the sea. I love the rocks. What's more, with you they'd never be a bore. I love being here with you. Singing in the shadows, laughing by the hour. Life's a breezy game. Love all kinds of weather, long as we're together. I love to hear you call my name. Situations. I was in an event in Suncoast Jazz Festival, which I have to tell you about. And I was lucky. I'm going to be in it again this year in November. But last November when I was leaving, I played and sang and And the weekend was over, and I was thinking, what a great time I had. And I went to my car, and as I approached my car, I saw somebody standing there taking a picture of my license plate. And I thought, oh crap, what did I do? And what does somebody think I did? And I said, excuse me, you're taking a picture of my license plate? And he said, yes. How come? It's funny. Well, my license plate says washboard. And I do play the washboard, we get to experience a little bit later. And it turns out he introduced himself, his name was Mitch Seidel. And he writes for Jersey Jazz, and he's a photographer. And he was talking to me and said he knew that I came from New Jersey. And would I consider ever coming up to do a gig in New Jersey? Sure, I said. My son lives nearby in Parsippany. Definitely, definitely. So that's how this evolved. And then I thought to myself, who will I get to play? Because they said, you know, call up another musician if you'd like to add somebody. I got to tell you, the first date I had with my late husband, he took me to see Marion McCartland at the Hickory House. And her bass player was Bill Crow. So how about that? This is nice an experience, and yeah, he's still doing his thing, I'm still doing my thing, you know. It's nice, music can go on like that forever. What I have down my little program here, I decided, so I rejoined Jersey Jazz and I started getting the publication, and I'm so impressed with the quality of musicians you have playing here. So I thought to myself, I'm going to perform a program consisting of some tunes that I do better than anybody else. The reason is, nobody else does them. They're songs that I wrote and nobody does. And I'd like to do this one now, which I wrote for a musician who I worked with here in New Jersey years ago. And he was going through really difficult times, personally, with his family, and he was an excellent player. So I wrote a song called Your Platonic Pal. And I think a lot of people have this experience. You have a platonic pal? Okay. Promote it, record it, make it a hit. I'm telling you straight, you're a specimen rat. You had some tough times, don't you despair. You just reached your prime, look out, world beware. Trust me, I'm your platonic pal. Joke, the laugh's overdue, but with your sense of humor, you will breeze along through your passing last. Here comes your debut. I wouldn't lie, I'm your platonic pal. Don't succumb to injury. You know, self-pity doesn't lead to success. Your future's bright and clearly defined. Just concentrate and liberate your creative mind. Well, you never know what could be achieved if you stop believing failure was preconceived. When your days become euphoric, just remember who believed in you. Future's bright and clearly defined. If you just concentrate and liberate your creative mind. Well, you never know what could be achieved. Just stop believing failure was preconceived. When your days become euphoric, just remember who believed in you. Your platonic pal, yeah. Just call me bosom buddy. You've got a friend. Thank you, thank you, thank you. see, what else do I have that I want to tell you about? Oh, the next song that I'd like to do for you is a song that is on my infamous album. And it came about because I was on a job with the late Larry Weiss. Do you remember Larry Weiss? He played the cornet, also played piano. And he was a very talented New Jersey musician. And he was noodling on the piano after the gig, and I said, "That's a beautiful tune. Does it have lyrics?" I was thinking I'd like to write them, and he said, "Yes, as a matter of fact, Warren Vache Sr. wrote the lyrics to this." So I asked permission to record it. And it goes like this. I think it's a beautiful tune. It has some interesting lyrics, and ladies, I'd like you to pay particular attention to some of the lyrics, because I'm curious about what you think when we're finished. It's called "Let Me Make Your Dreams Come True." And thank you, Bill. Bill, I just mailed him some stuff, and he brought it, and he's playing it. This is amazing. Thank you. I guess I didn't feel that way. I said, what about really living now? People, you know, do you really think like somebody would say, go out and do what you want, and whenever you want, I'll be here? And so Warren Sr. said to me, funny you should say that. I wrote it for a man to sing. Oh, well, that's okay then. Anyway, pretty funny. Well, I do a lot of different things, and so I'm like, I can't be pegged as a jazz vocalist or singing ballads or singing funny songs. I like to do a lot of different things, and what I have now on my list comes from a show that I produced. Well, the song was around before I wrote it, but I wrote a show called Fanny Bryce Tells All, and in it, I come back as Fanny Bryce, and I come down from heaven for the first time, and I don't play the piano for it. I have it all on recorded music, so I can stand up and be funny and do crazy dances and stuff like that. But for this purpose, I'll just use one of the songs, because Fanny says at one point, when she greets her live audience, the breathing audience that she hasn't seen for a while, and she says, I'll tell you what, let's make a deal. I'll do something for you. I'll tell you what you want to know about my life. If you promise to stop doing something that drives me bananas, because sometime I'm up on cloud nine, I look down, and I see somebody goes into a club, and they say to the girl singer, Miss, would you please sing Secondhand Rose like Barbra Streisand? Like Barbra Streisand? Why like Barbra Streisand? Why not like Fanny Bryce, the original? I'm the one who introduced that song. Barbra, she's a secondhand Fanny. I'm the one who was up on the Broadway stage and I said, give me one of those G arpeggio DiMaggio things, and I started singing. Father had a business, strictly secondhand, everything for toothpicks to a baby grand. Stuff in our apartment came from Father's store. Everything I'm wearing, someone wore before. It's no wonder that I feel abused. I never had a thing that ain't been used. Secondhand clothes. That's why they call me what?
Secondhand
clothes. Even my piano in a parlor. He's the guy I adore. Had the nerve to tell me he'd been married before. Oh, everyone knows I'm only secondhand.
lot to carry.
Even Jacob Lama, he's the guy I adore. He had the knife to tell me he'd been married before. Whoa, everyone knows I'm only second out of row.
I will do that show anytime, any place. It's a 1 hour show and it's so much fun and I get a kick out of seeing people laughing and it's good. So, and I got a gig coming up on my birthday. That's the best thing to do.
When's your birthday?
December. But I have one in when I get back in May also. But I thought, oh yeah, December 13th, that's so great because I don't want to party. You know, so as I said, I'm going to do songs that have never been done better by anybody else because I haven't done it. This song I wrote years ago, I was living in New Jersey, and I had the opportunity to play for a sales convention in New York. And the Mayor Ed Koch was there. Did he like the song? I have no idea. But I played it anyway because I thought it was fun. Oops. And it's, do anybody remember what his slogan was?
How am I doing?
How am I doing so far? Yeah. How am I doing so far? So, you want to join in? You know when to come in. I'm sure you'll be instinctive. And it's about sales. I've been a number one salesperson all my career. My products ran from chic to bizarre. I'm trying to sell you that my love is sincere. How am I doing so far? I don't need to sound slick with my presentation if my strategy is not up to par. I just want to convince you of my motivation. Folks, how am I doing so far? Could I interest you or create a desire? Is my goal-setting tactic believable? If the only approach I know sounds strange to you, I swear I'm no account receivable. My ultimate goal is to sell you my soul. You're as challenging as catching a star. I'm foolproof and ready for you to control. Folks, how am I doing so far?
Motivation, folks. Well,
how am I doing?
You're as challenging as catching a star. I'm foolproof, ready for you to control.
How am I doing so far?
I'm a bargain.
How am I doing so far?
My pumps are guaranteed. Belonged to Jersey Jazz for quite a while, but back in the day when I was here, I was write a couple of columns for Jersey Jazz, which was a lot of fun. I wrote about where I went. I have the copies of the columns at home, which I was thinking maybe I'll Xerox them and bring them. And I thought, how much of an ego do I have? Big one. No, I have. It was fun doing it. But I was very grateful because somebody passed that opportunity on to me, and she's here now. Does anybody remember June Peacock wrote a column? Raise your hand, June. June Peacock was now June Stairs, but she was writing a column for Jersey Jazz and then moved on and said, would you like to go? Yes. So it was a lot of fun. But the magazine, now that I've resubscribed to it, really impressed with all the stories and everything that's going on. Very active. Magazine. So what do I have for you next? Well, I didn't write this one down. I think I know it. I really haven't done it, but... remember Mabel Mercer? Cabaret performer. Yeah, she would just kind of talk through with very dramatic songs. This is a song that was it was beautifully written, and the lyrics are so interesting. It became something that she was well known for, and also Nancy Wilson. So I'll tell you a little bit more about it after I do it, which I think is interesting. I don't know if I mentioned it, because how did he look? How did he look? Did he seem happy? While they were dancing, did he whisper things in her ear? And did he light her cigarette? Was he attentive? The way he used to be? What was she like? Was she attractive? Was there a smile upon his face, or did he look bored? Not that I really care. I know our love affair can never be. Musicians of fame have recorded it. Does anybody know who wrote that song? No.
Gladys Shelley.
Who knows that? He knew Gladys Shelley. Now Gladys Shelley also wrote this song. And this one I had to write down. I think I would know this one. But and I think you're gonna know this one. Palisades has the rise, Palisades has the fun. Come on over, shows and dancing, all free, so the pockets are clean. Come on over, Palisades from coast to coast, where a dime buys the most. Palisades amusement park, swings and the waves of the pool will have fun. So come on.
People remember that tune, right? Who ever went to class when you used to talk? Did you know that? I lived in Cliffside Park. So right next to Fort Lee was all the properties. And when I was 14 years old, I saw cotton candy there on the park. And so it was such a joyful memory for me. And later on, someone, Dean Scott Drew, wrote a book called The History of Palisades Park, 100 Years of Fond Memories. I bought the book, I got in contact with him, and said, if you ever want music, if you're ever going to do anything, I'll play three. It brought me back such great memories. And he said, matter of fact, I want to make the video sometime, but I don't know how to make the video, but I want to do it, but I don't know how much it will cost. And I said, wait, I know somebody who can ask how much it will cost. They won't do it because they're busy, they're too busy, so they won't be doing it themselves. But they can tell you how much it'll cost so nobody rips you off. My son and his partner had a video production company. They were very busy. They were supporting their families, their three kids. They're not gonna take on this project. So I had Vince Gargiola, Dave Camora, and his partner David Fell, myself, and we met just to get advice. And it came as a shock to me when David Kumar said, I'll tell you what we'll do, Vince. We'll take care of the production and the cost of that, and you write the script. And the whole thing happened. And I don't know if anybody saw it. It was a documentary on PBS. But, and we produced it. And I had, at that time, was working with my husband doing publicity for Ken Burns' documentaries. And I said to Ken Burns, if you know anybody that's hungry to do narration, my son and I are going to be doing a documentary about Palisade Amusement Park. And Ken said, if you can't get anybody, I'll do it. And I called up David and said, don't get anybody. And Ken, he's a darling. He's a wonderful person. And not only did he do the narration free for us, but he invited us up to New Hampshire to his studio to use his facilities and everything. So it came out great, and I'm making this donation. Actually, David's making that because I'm staying in his house now.
David, raise your hand. Two seconds.
So this is for the Jersey Jazz Society. I was going to give it to Mitch, but he's not here. So the person in charge of the Jazz Society, I think you'll have a good time. You're going to accept it?
All right. Accepting the award.
Invite everyone. What's your name?
Marcia.
Marcia will have everybody over to her house to see the show. It's really nice, and it brings back a lot of memories. I couldn't believe how many people met there. They met their spouses there. Oh, he is, isn't he? Yeah, they call it national treasure. He's great. I'm still in touch with him. He's really good. Well, let's see. I didn't know how to time this. I was supposed to be like 45 minutes.
Thank you so much.
What time is it? Okay. So the power of advertising. People remember Palisade Amusement Park had a lot of advertising all across the country. But here's another example of the power of advertising. And it's about a show that was done in Greenwich Village by the garment workers. And they weren't even professional performers, but the show was such a big hit that it was reproduced. The show is called Pins and Needles, and the song is called Dear Beatrice Fairfax. There was a, before Dear Abby, there was a Dear Beatrice Fairfax. I want a man that I can squeeze, that I can tease.
You're not drinking anymore.
That I can please two or three or four or more. What are those fools waiting for? I want love and I want kissing. I want more of what I'm missing. Nobody's knocking at my front door. What do they think my knocker's for? Anyway, if they don't come soon, there won't be any more. What can the matter of me? I wash my clothes with love. I etiquette to death.
I spend my hard-earned bucks on what those heads do. Oh dear, what can a matter be? Nobody makes a pass at me. I use tongs on my skin by Rikers I back there. Take that in my culture. I read Gone with the Wind. Oh dear, what can the matter be, huh? Nobody makes a pass at me. Dear Beatrice Fairfax, give me the bad facts. How do you make them fall? If you don't save me the things that God gave me, never will be any use to me at all. I spring upon a dad for your instruction. I guess. Oh dear, what can a matter be? Nobody makes a pass at me. I use Ovaltine and Listerine, Barbasol and Mustirol, Lifebuoy soap and Flip. Why ain't I got it? I lose Coca-Cola and Mamola, castor oil, a little Mazola, Playtex and Latex. Why ain't I got sex? I use Aveline and Maybelline, Odorono and Sensation, Castor Oil, a little more sensation. Why ain't I got fascination? Well, I use Mum every day to give myself a cure, but still men stay away, like ivory soap. I'm pure. Oh dear, what can a matter be? Nobody makes a pass. Products, the advertising companies were just really glorious, and there are things we can remember today. Does anybody remember what the product was? The slogan was, it covers the earth. Yeah, Sherwin-Williams paint. Right. And another one was Snap, Crackle, Pop. Christie's. The Breakfast of Champions. Yeah. And 57 varieties?
Times.
Yeah, just funny. Alterations without charge?
Robert Hall.
Robert Hall. Oh! Okay, what else? You got another one?
Bargain Day.
Oh, yeah. Oh, well, at this point, oh my gosh, the time is going on. This is the time that I would like to introduce my grandson. Teddy Kumar, he's playing here for us. He came down to the college. Okay. All right. Yeah, so. First, I'm going to sit down and let Teddy pick a song that he wants to do because he has the honor of playing. Wonderful bass player.
Thank you.
The thing that, the shtick that got me the gig was the washboard. So I thought to close the set, I'm going to bring the washboard. Gershwin tune, I got rid of it. Well now, he's got rhythm, he's got music. I got this gig. Who needs more? I got daisies and green pastures. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Benny, for a great first set.
And so it's my job in life, I do believe, to inspire you to follow your dreams. And as I was going around during the break, I know that Patricia is one. Some of you folks are afraid to even suggest that you might be able to become a professional washboard player like myself and make the big bucks that I do. But I decided that I'm going to share it with you because it's such a warm feeling in this room. So, and all it takes to become a professional washboard player are two qualifications. One, this is number one. You gotta have a natural sense of rhythm. Oh yeah. And if you have that qualification, the second is, you have to have absolutely and positively no pride. Bill is right. You have to have a washboard. Now, don't let this heavy metal instrument scare you. So to get started, I'm going to put on my gloves, and I'm going to need a little cooperation from some of you. Well, most of you have rhythm, so you'll help me out, I'm sure. I'm going to snap off fingers to the rhythm, and I'll tell you how you can go and become a jazz musician in 24 hours or less. One. Help me out. One. Dun. Dun, dun, dun. You get a washboard from the hardware store. You know, nobody's using it for washing no more. And whether you're giants or whether you're midges, well, you gotta get some thimbles for your digits. So that's the beginning. Once you have that, you can go out and play professionally on the streets for tips. And I'm gonna give you a little tip because you're all my close friends now. I come from Sarasota. Right outside the Ritz-Carlton Hotel can be very lucrative. It's true. They give me $100 just to get away. So, but you gotta be careful because if you are a jazz musician, there's always, and I'm sure Bill will attest to this, there's always somebody looking over your shoulder to take your gig, right? So you gotta be sharp. You gotta keep up to date. You gotta be a little special. So the first thing, did I do this yet? You get a washboard from the hardware store?
Yes.
Okay, so then what you gotta do is, after you play in the streets, you gotta accelerate. You gotta add some eccentricities onto your acts, man, because you gotta set yourself up higher than the other person who's looking for your gig. So, once again, one, two, oh! You take that washboard into the room, yeah, told you that, and then you add those eccentricities onto your acts. One, two. Here we go. A whistle, a siren, kazoo that hums. You get it at the music store, near the drums. A woodblock, a cymbal, a cab of a cash. And you can find it at your local Simon Ash. Okay, so now you are ready. You're ready for Lincoln Center, Kennedy Center, the White House. You know, the sky's the limit.
Once
you, the subways, yeah. You might even go to that depth. But anyhow, you are ready to play any gig, but never stop looking over your shoulder, because no matter how much of a novelty or how great you get on your instrument, somebody's looking to take your gig. So I gotta tell you, a couple of years ago, I added two big visual effects to my act. So now I am the only female washboard player in Sarasota that has both a pigtail and wrinkles. So I'm washboard woman, rhythms in my hands. I play around with any willing bands. Now you may tap your feet to a syncopated beat, but I go rat-a-tat, bang on this and that, like a cat in heat. The whistle's for the tootsie train. I blow the duck call when I feel insane. Now you just sit and listen, but I'll tell you what you're missing. Playing washboard
is like wandering your brain.
I don't know if you know Coney Island washboard, but I couldn't see. That's okay.
Da 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 da. I'm washboarding rhythms in my head. I play around with any willing bands. Now you may tap your feet to a sink of pig and feet, but I get out of that, I get this and that, like a cat in the heat. The whistles for that toot-toot-tootsie train. I blow the duck call when I feel insane. Just keep it going, pass the torch.
That's your job.
Skips a generation. Keep going.
Yeah.
A lot of people have asked me how I got started playing the washboard. And I don't know if anybody knows Barbara Drywitz, a tuba player.
Yeah.
I know you do.
Yeah.
So I was singing with a group in New York City for 4 years. It was called John Booker's Speakeasy Jazz Babies, and I was their vocalist. And one day, they had a job at Nelson Doubleday's estate, but they didn't want a drummer because they were moving from place to place to place. And so she said to me, get yourself a washboard and some thimbles and keep time for us. And I said, are you kidding? And I thought, oh my God, well, I don't care if they lose the job, it's not my gig. And it turns out, she said, just don't do anything fancy, just keep straight rhythm, and you can come. So I went with them, I played, and when the job was over, the banjo player said, let me put you on my washboard list. He had actually a list of washboard players. And I started getting the calls, and the calls would say, make sure the washboard player's on the job. So one thing led to another. And if you look it up, I'm not really that unique. There are washboard players, not just across the country, but around the world. And each one has one more creative or funnier than the next one. One woman I was on stage with, I was so jealous. She had two washboards together on hinges. And at one point, she opened it up, an American flag went up, and the light said, applause. Applause. And it was great. So I'm really thrilled to be here. I am. And I have reached an age, the age of the person I went to see who sang at the cookery. Probably Bill would know. And a lot of you would know. But I thought at the time, how does she do it? How does she do it? Look how old she is. It was Alberta Hunter.
Oh my gosh.
Alberta Hunter. Oh my gosh. She was such an inspiration. And she was 80 years old. And she had these long dangle earrings. And she would stand there and sing her song. And she had a great pianist. Oh, do you know who it was? A piano player? I can't think of his name. But you, I'm sure you saw her do. And she was just super. So this is one of the songs that I saw her do. And I loved it. Loved it.
It was at the cookery.
And what's his name, Barney Josephson? Yeah. And Alberta Hunter, the story is, she was a great jazz singer and performer. When she became 60, her mom died, and she was very, very close to her mother. So she didn't want to sing again, and she gave up singing, and she went into nursing at the age of 60. But she lied about her age, said she was 40, looked 20 years younger than me.
Oh, wow.
And she was a nurse. And then Barney Josephson, who owned the cookery, saw her later at a party and hired her when she came back to sing at the age of 80. Incredible. Ain't I good to you? Nothing's too good for a guy. Good truth. Gee, baby, ain't out the team. I bought you a coat for Christmas.
Blossom Dearie's a song, I'm Hip. Remember Blossom Dearie? She was a cabaret singer, and she had a little girl's voice like, I'm Hip, what a dream. And she played the piano like crazy. She's a great jazz pianist and a wonderful singer. And so my friend Jack Burns wrote a parody on New Hip, and the lyrics are, on I'm Hip, and it's called New Hip. And it goes, I'm gonna do it in Blossom Dearie style. Do I have it here? Yeah, I have it here. Just in case. And new hip, what a trip. I can tango or slam dance or dip. I can skip across the street. On my own feet, isn't that neat? It's better than my tummy grip, my new hip. Plastic knees, what a breeze. To replace one out pots when it breathes. Now my name's on every list. When someone dies, I'll get their eyes. I'm a new perfectionist, get the gist. The whole process was great. Thanks to pumps that provide the narcotics. Pretty soon I can't wait. I am going to burn my orthotics. I'll get perky boobs, tucks and nips. I'll get fat from my butt, from my lips. As a final fuck to close. Sure, it will cost. But you can pay through someone else's nose if you chose. Take a tip. Get a new hip. So, by the way, if you folks are really bored when you get home, you can see that on YouTube. Biddy Kamara. And my surgeon liked it so much that I went back and had the other hip done. So, and it was worth it. And it was really worth it. So now I'd like to feature Bill, because when I checked up, like I said, we hadn't been in touch for so many years, and I thought, is he still playing? Am I still playing? You know, you never really know. And so sure, checked out the website, and I see that he sings. So he's going to sing a song for us.
Yay!
Sing!
I always want to say anything. When I grew up out in the state of Washington, we were near Seattle, and my grandparents lived out in eastern Washington in the desert, in Othello. So we frequently took train trips across the mountains there. And so a trip on a train in those days was a very exciting thing. These days, if you say you take a trip on a train, they think you're swallowing a pill. But this song was written in the days when railroads were it. And Johnny Mercer's lyric goes like this.
Every stop that we made,
at the track, the one going back to you. What did I do?
Getting some calls. That's nice, and that's a beautiful tune too. I love. I have the recording. Ella Fitzgerald.
Really, really nice.
Who did you like best, Ella Fitzgerald or Dinosaur?
Bronco. Yeah, everybody know about Bill Crow's books, Jazz Anecdotes.
Oh man, yeah, so funny.
Really
The musician submitted. Did you ever read it, Jim?
Thank you.
It's anecdotes that jazz musicians through the years submitted, funny things that happen on jobs, and I submitted too, and they never made your book, but they made the 802 column that you wrote. Funny things happened to me through the years, such bizarre and funny things that my daughter says she's going to write a book called My Mother Should Be Committed. But I have a lot of good material. Here's a song that was written by, he became a friend of mine, he wrote it way before I knew him. His name was Lou Carter, and he was from New Jersey. Does anybody remember Lou Carter?
The girl with the three blue eyes.
Oh, yeah. Oh, really?
He wrote that song.
The girl with the three blue eyes, that's funny, I didn't know that. But I knew him as a piano player, I worked on the show, but then I found out, after getting to know him, that he ended up being on the Perry Como show. He was the piano player for the Perry Como show in the band, but he wrote very funny parodies, very funny songs. And the musician submitted it to the director of the show, and then suddenly he was thrust into the limelight, and he was like the Perry Como's chauffeur. That's how they presented it. Louie, the singing cab driver. And Lou, and he would be on camera, and he would, what were some of the other ones? Do you remember?
I had a nose full of nickels. I chew.
And another one that he co-wrote with his friend was Woody Herman Band recorded. It was, I told you, I love you, now get out. But here's a more upbeat one, and I think it should be the national anthem for female musicians. It goes like this. It's called For a Girl. People listen, people smile. People like my swinging style. They tell me I play good for a girl. Oops. I always love that tater touch. Wish I could play half as much. Still they say I'm good for a girl. Since Toto felt femininity is my happy fate. It makes me laugh when people say, hey man, you play great. They see Prim and Oscar P. Well, one big fraternity. And brother, that ain't bad for a girl. Smile. People like my swinging style.
good for a girl. Sometimes I'd like to thank my audience with bass notes that say, your compliments inspired me in a left-handed way. Cause every time that I perform, I try to lay up a storm. Hurricane name, Acme Super, to show I blew such good piano. Well, I can hit some right notes, and I play pretty good for a girl.
Teddy's going to be coming back, everybody. I know you're clamoring. We finished at 5:30, so I got a couple more songs. I want to do this song that I wrote. I was so fortunate in life that some of the things that I've experienced. And there's a club in England called Pizza on the Park. You heard of it? It's great, right across the street from my park corner. And they had many wonderful, fantastic jazz pianists playing in there. You'd go in. And the street level was a pizza place. And you went downstairs and they had these wonderful little tables and checkered tablecloths and candlelight, and they had two grand pianos. The first set was played by one pianist, the second by the other, and the third set you played together. And I was invited to play there, and it was thrilling. But I also knew the history of the place, so I wrote this song, which I started every morning, I've started the first thing every set to sort of set up what they should expect. And it worked. Isn't it a rock? I'm here in London playing Pizza on the Park. My friends all envy me. I feel like going strutting. Dick Wellstead and Ralph Sutton both played this baby grand. Don't misunderstand, well I can't play like they. I tried but only found my thumbs got in the way. But on the other hand, I never heard them sing. It might as well be spring, the fact of which allows me this remark. I'm proud to play at Pizza on the Park. Oh my gosh, they were so great. Johnny Parker, blah, 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 I forget one of them, and Eddie Thompson, blind, fantastic jazz pianist, who went to school with George Sheeran, thank you. They went to the same school together in England, in the music school, and they knew each other, and I got to know, and I wrote a story for the Jersey Jazz about Eddie Thompson. And when he came to New York afterwards, I said, you know who's in New York? George Sheeran. Do you get together? And Eddie said, oh yeah, we always get together, I go there, I put my fingers in his ears and say, guess who? Oh, I forgot to tell you, they're both blind. Oh yeah, they're both blind. Both blind jazz pianists, which was why it was a funny thing to say. I put my fingers in his ears and say, guess who? And the other piano player that who worked with me here at Peace on the Park was Neville Dickey, who's been here in this country now.
Yeah.
He plays ragtime piano, and he loved the washboard. So that was me. I had a wonderful time. Okay, I'm going to do another song, and then I'm going to call Tim back. But a song that I did. Does anybody remember Chuck Spees? Do you remember Chuck Spees? Oh, you worked with him a lot? Yeah, I did too. He was darling. He was so terrific. He played at the Radio City, and his wife was a rock hit, and you know, they both passed on early in life, which was very sad. He did. He had drums from, he had about four different sets of drums and different styles of music, and very unique person. So I had fun working with him, very clever. And he wrote this song. No, he didn't write this song. I'm not doing the song he wrote. I do this song he wrote called Dixieland. What I like is to be Dixieland. And he was like, I'm not singing the Dixieland. But why I mention him is because he and I were playing a duo gig. June was there. And it was so many years ago. It was a club called Mickey's, and it was long like a bowling alley. And so the piano was up on the, and the drums on this maybe 10 inches off the floor, so we could be visible, you know, back further. And Chuck was such a great drummer that he was inspiring me to play better than I knew I could play. So we're playing Love for Sale, and he's playing so good, and I'm inspired, and I move back to get a little elbow room, and the chair fell off the back of the stage. Luckily, I didn't get hurt, and I was hysterical laughing because I thought, here I am playing Love for Sale, and suddenly I'm on the floor. What am I selling? No, and I just, it just was so funny, I couldn't stop laughing. I get back up, and I thought, well, I can't go back to that song. So this is the song I started playing. I'm flying high, and I got a feeling I'm falling. And I got such a big hand. And June, you might not remember this, but you were audio taping it. And you gave me the tape the next day. And what you hear is you hear the music, then you hear silence, and then I hear June's voice on it. Did she do that on purpose? It was so funny. And I didn't see it. And so now I'll do it with the verse. Oh honey, you're driving me crazy. You're working too fast. How long can I last? I'm flying high. I got a feeling I'm falling. Falling for nobody else but you. You got my Irish, right? Got a Philadelphia.
destiny. Well, I didn't know you only step passes. How long? I'm really falling. I don't know what for you. It's true. I got a crush on you, sweetie pie, all the day and night time. Baby sigh, I never had the least notion that I could fall with such emotion. Could you coo? Could you care for a cunning cottage that we alone could share? The world will pardon my much. I have got a crush, my baby, on you.
Positive day and experience and everything else, and everybody wonders about this, and the answer is D I do. In a key of F. Yeah. Okay, that's what I do.
Thank you. found you. That's why I'm always hanging around you. Do I need you? Oh my, do I, honey? Did I say Teddy? Did I, well, baby? Teddy, that's great. And he came down just to be with me for the day. And now he rides back in the morning. This is my mantra. Other people have other things that they say to get themselves going and feel up and positive. And this is how I start. And my mentor, Jimmy Durante, taught me. Uh-oh. Am I doing it in the wrong key?
Gotta start off each day with a song. Even when things go wrong, you'll feel better, you'll even look better. And I'm here to tell you, you'll be a go-getter. When you shake my hand, makes me understand it's better to go through life with a smile and a song than wearing a puss 11 miles long. And no, things can't go wrong. Start off each day with a song. Everybody, you gotta start off each day with a song. Even when things go wrong, you'll feel better. You'll feel better. You'll even look better. And I'm here to tell you, you'll be a go-getter. The way you shake my hand, when you shake my hand, will make me understand.
Thank you. Let's do this again.